Thanks for joining us again today at Salvation Studio House. We are continuing on with the book, The Life and Death of Mr. Badman. You can go to our website, salvationstudiohouse.com, click on the Illustrated Message tab, and click on the link there to The Life and Death of Mr. Badman, read all the reviews that we have. You can also go to the video link and watch some of the videos that we've done. If you haven't downloaded the book into your PC or mobile device, you can do so at preachershelp.net. Click on their books tab and download it and read along with us. Today we are wrapping up chapter 8. And so this is part 3, and you can read pages 71 to 73, talking about how Badman goes bankrupt and Bayat gets hatfuls of money. So today's program is somewhat twofold in wrapping up this chapter. It's talking about Christians, yes, Christians, who beguile and deceive, and they use the word breaking in the script, and also how God can miraculously provide for the righteous who find themselves in debt unwillingly. So we're going to start out by reading from page 71. Where Attentive is kind of making a case for Badman, if Badman were alive, to be able to defend himself and what he could have possibly said to so-called Christians who are doing exactly the same thing as he was doing. So, and that was deceiving and beguiling and defrauding fellow people. And so don't think that the world doesn't see what's going on and what Christians are doing. They see very good. So let's read it. It says, "Yet they are guilty of neglect in their calling, of living higher, both in food and clothing, than their trade or income will maintain. Besides, that they break, all the world knows very well, and that they have the art to plead for a settlement is very well known to men. And thus they deceive men, harden their consciences, sin against their profession, being a Christian, and give heed, it is to be feared, to their lusts. In all of this, and the fulfillment of them in their end." So the script continues on with Attentive. It says, "I repeat, if Mr. Badman were here to object to you, what would your reply be?" "What?" says Mr. Wiseman. "Why, I would say, I hope no good man, no one in good conscience, no one that either fears God or regards the credit of religion and the peace of God's people or the salvation of their soul could do this. Such professors perhaps there may be, and who on earth can help it? Disreputable men there are of all colors. If men profess and make their profession as a stalking horse to deceive their neighbors out of their estates, as Mr. Badman himself did, when he deceived the woman that is now his sorrowful wife, what can we do about it? The churches of old were pestered with such people, and therefore no wonder we live in such perilous times as today." So it still is going on today, isn't it? There is no difference. Society hasn't changed much. Let's read what the Apostle Paul tells Timothy in 2 Timothy 3, verses 1. It says, "But know this, that in the last day perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness," and that is such a key, "having a form of godliness, but denying its power. From such people turn away." I'd like to also read what Paul says in the book of 2 Corinthians 6, 1 to 11, and I'm just going to highlight a few of the verses. It says, "If then you have judgments concerning things pertaining to this life, do you appoint those who are least esteemed by the church to judge? I say this to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you, not even one who will be able to judge between his brethren? But brother goes to law against brother, and that before unbelievers? Now therefore, it is already an utter failure that you go to law against one another. Why do you not And this is a key here, and that's why I have it underlined. Why do you not rather accept wrong? Why do you not rather let yourself be cheated? No, you yourselves do wrong and cheat, and you do these things to your brethren. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. And it goes on to talk about those who will not inherit the kingdom of God. So the Apostle Paul has a very firm and strong admonition to Christians who are taking one another to court on account of debt or on account of cheating and beguiling and defrauding. It says instead there that you should accept a wrong done and let yourself be cheated instead of going to court. Nowadays, it's almost like that seems so far from the truth of what is going on. And yet it's very clear in the Bible and in talking about debt that this is the preferred way of doing things as Christians, right? And Paul is very firm saying, should there not be brothers and leaders inside the church to be able to handle situations like this instead of taking it to the ungodly who are going to judge you in ungodly ways and ungodly systems? So I think we need to take heed of this warning that the Apostle Paul is giving and that Wiseman is stating in this case of what has happened. We need wise counsel in the church today. Jesus articulates this very well on the Sermon on the Mount, doesn't he? Read together with me in Matthew 5:38-42. It says, "You have heard that it is said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. But whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. If anyone wants to sue you and take away your tunic, let him have your cloak also. And whoever compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too. Give to him who asks you, and from him who wants to borrow, do not turn him away." We also read where Jesus says in Luke 6:34-36, "And if you lend to those from whom you hope to receive back, what credit is that to you? For even sinners lend to sinners and to receive as much back. But love your enemies, do good and lend, hoping for nothing in return, and your reward will be great." And I think that's very key. "And you will be sons of the Most High, for he is kind to the unthankful and evil. Therefore, be merciful, just as your Father is merciful." So God says to lend and to not expect anything in return, to walk in humility. So if you have somebody that's wanting to borrow something in your life, like money or a vehicle or whatever that may be, if you're hemming and hawing, you know, should I, shouldn't I, is this the right thing, or let me just pray about it and find out if I should do this, I think Jesus is very clear that we shouldn't even take thought of those things. And usually it's the things that are more value to us that we're being asked to lend to that count the most and are the hardest, right, to let go of. But really, should they be? You know, we should really have a very loose perception on the things that we hold dear to our hearts when someone is asking to borrow it or that we're to lend to. We should take it very lightly and be able to give and say, sure, brother, sure, sister, I can give that to you, I can lend it to you, and really in our heart not expecting anything in return, right? And here's maybe another example. I don't know if it's happened to you. I've heard stories of it happening to people that, let's say someone has been given something, they've received an award for their excellent work or their achievement or academic achievements, etc. And they end up giving it to somebody else. And that person, when they receive it, this is a little bit of a, not a bunny trail, but a train of thought. That person who receives this object or this thing ends up finding a brother or a sister in need, and they turn around and give it to them. Well, when the person who originally gave it finds out that you gave it away, they are like, what did you do? I gave it to you. What are you doing turning around and giving it away? That was something real special to me that I really held on to that dearly. Well, I think that person really needs to weigh in their heart, you know what? I gave it away. When you give something, it is no longer yours. We shouldn't be expecting to hold on to that and that it still belongs. When you give it away, it's no longer yours. End of story. The person that has received it, if they're being obedient to what God has called them to do, then let them do what God has called them to do, and don't be offended with their with what they've decided to do. Now, I just want to clarify that there could be every Tom, Dick, and Harry that could come across your path, and they're asking for everything, and we're not talking about that. We're talking about specific cases where people are coming and lending. You need God's wisdom in this, and God will give you wisdom in this, but to know that in the bigger picture, that when we do lend to someone something, that we're not to expect anything in return. I hope that's clear, and we don't want to misinterpret that scripture. So let's go on to what Wiseman says. But their false profession, we can't do anything about. What can we do if men ascribe to themselves the title of holy ones, godly ones, zealous ones, self-denying ones, or any other glorious titles? And while they call themselves this, they may be very rogues of all evil, sin, and villainy imaginable, and who can help it? True, they are a scandal to religion, a grief to the honest-hearted, an offense to the world, and a stumbling stone to the weak. And these offenses have come, do come, and will come. Whatever in the world can we do about it? But woe to those through whom offenses come. And Jesus even talks about offenses, doesn't he, in Matthew 18, 6 to 8. He says, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to sin, it would be better for him for a millstone to be hung about around his neck and he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe to the world because of offenses. For offenses must come, but woe to that man by whom offenses come. If your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed rather than having two hands and two feet and to be cast into the lake of everlasting fire. It's very clear what Jesus is talking about here. Woe to the person who causes Christians to stumble. We're talking here about beguiling and deceiving. It says, woe to the one who rips you off. Woe to the one who is doing things wrong and cheating and undermining. Jesus sees it. And the judgment of that person in the very end is going to be very swift. It is unacceptable for Christians to live in duality. Either you're a Christian on this side of the fence or you're in the world. Jesus says if you're in the middle of, you know, splitting the fence, you know, he's going to vomit you out of his mouth, according to the book of Revelation. And that's who Jesus was talking, that's who Wiseman was talking about in this quote above, you know, talking about the holy one and the godly one and the zealous one. You know what? The Apostle Peter also really denounces the depravity of those who Wiseman is talking about, that these people are in the churches. It says in 2 Peter 2:12 to 17, but these, like natural brute beasts made to be caught and destroyed, speak evil of all things they do not understand and will utterly perish in their own corruption and will receive the wages of unrighteousness. As those who count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime, they are spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deceptions, while they feast with you. Did you get that? They feast with you in churches, having eyes full of adultery that cannot cease from sin, enticing unstable souls. That's who we're talking about here. They have a heart trained in covetousness. That's just like Mr. Badman, trained in covetous practices, and are accursed children. They have forsaken the way, the right way, and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. But he was rebuked for his iniquity. A dumb donkey speaking with a man's voice restrained the madness of the prophet. These are wells without water, clouds carried by the tempest, for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. The Apostle Peter says that these type of people are in the churches. Whether we want to believe it or not, it is so. And they're enticing unstable Christians. And it's really sad to see that. Both in 2 Corinthians 7, 1 and 2 and Romans 13, 8 to 10, it says, gives guidelines on how Christians are to live. It says, therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse us ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. Open your hearts to us. We have wronged no one. We have corrupted no one. We have cheated no one. And it also says, owe no one anything except to love one another, for he who loves one another has fulfilled all the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not covet. And if there's any other commandment are summed up in this saying, namely, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no one any harm to their neighbor. Love, therefore, is the fulfillment of the law. You know, the early church had everything in common. They held on, as I said earlier, to their things very loosely. They understood the teaching of Jesus to give, to share, to be generous, and not hold tightly to their treasures. But our society says, yeah, but, oh, you know what? We hum and haw, when really we have no excuse to hum and haw. If every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, you know, everything that we have really is his because he's blessed us. So we should have a disposition to be able to give. So in this kind of first part, we see how Mr. Badman was kind of turning the tables on the Christians, and he was saying, you know what, I know what I'm doing. And Mr. Badman took pride in what he was doing. He said, I know what I'm doing. I'm defrauding. I'm doing this and that because I want to make a buck. But he turned the table and he says, it's in the church. So instead of pointing the finger at me, take a look at yourselves, see what's going on within those who are so-called Christians. The world is watching, and you got to judge for yourself. So that's kind of the first part. Mr. Badman was calling it out as it was, saying, I know I'm bad, but look at yourselves and judge yourselves first of all. So we go on to the second part of the last part of this chapter. And it talks about those who are righteous, but find themselves in debt, and how God miraculously provided for them. I think this is a really great way to wrap up this chapter. Let's read what Mr. Attentive says on pages 72 and 73. Attentive, but suppose God should blow upon a professor in his estate and occupation, and he should fall into difficulty before he is aware. Must he be counted in the same company as Mr. Badman and lie under the same reproach as he? Wise men, no, not if he has done all he could to avoid it. It is possible for a ship to sink at sea, despite the most faithful orders of the most skillful pilot under heaven. And thus, as I suppose it was with the prophet that left his wife in debt, risking the slavery of her children to the creditors, according to 2 Kings 4, 1 and 2. He was not a wasteful man, nor was he given to fraud, for the text says that he feared God. Yet I say he was in debt more than his wife could pay off. Elisha tells this widow woman, collect all the jars, all the vessels that you can. So she does. They go into her room. He prays over it. And what happens? The oil multiplies and the jars are filled. He says, go and sell all the oil that you need to pay off all your debts. And what's left over, you can live off of it. Isn't that just... That is such an amazing story. Wow, what a powerful testimony. The key point here is put God first. And that's exactly what this widow woman did. She put God first. She listened to the voice of the prophet and she got out of debt in a miraculous way. Here's another miraculous story. It's in 1 Kings 17, 1 to 15. And it's the story of the prophet Elijah. So we just kind of review this quickly. We see that God used scavenger birds, ravens, to feed the prophet while he was at this brook. This was over a three-year period. So every day, the prophet is getting meat and food from these scavenger birds, who their innate character is to eat everything that they get, right? Who knows, maybe they were getting it off of the table of King Ahab and Jezebel and snatching it from their plate and taking it off to feed the prophet Elijah. Who knows, he kind of got to be, you know, you just wonder how it all happened, how it all came down. But I think it's pretty amazing that there he was fed at the brook for 3 years. What happens when the brook dries up? He says, I want you to go to a widow woman in Zarephath. Now imagine that. This widow woman, the prophet probably should have been helping out first of all, but God had already told the woman and prepared her to minister to the needs of the prophet. So again, we see obedience. She was about to die, but the prophet says, I want you to prepare food for me. And she does, she prepares it. And then God miraculously provides for her. And the flour didn't run out and the oil didn't run out while the drought was continuing on. So I'm going to ask you this question. What destitute position do you find yourself in life right now? If you're walking uprightly and righteously before God, you can expect that He will provide miraculously for you. Only God sees your heart. He knows what's going on. So let's look at Peter and Jesus. It talks about a great story here in Matthew 17, 24 to 27. It says, when they had come to Capernaum, those who received the temple tax came to Peter and said, does your teacher not pay the temple tax? He said, yes. And when he had come into the house, Jesus anticipated him saying, what do you think, Simon? From whom do the kings of the earth take customs or taxes? From their sons or from strangers? Peter said to him, from strangers. And Jesus said to him, then the sons are free. Nevertheless, lest we offend them, listen to this, I love it. Go to the sea, cast in a hook, and take out the fish that comes up first. And when you have opened its mouth, you will find a piece of money. Take that and give it to them for me and for you. I'd also like to read what Jesus says in Matthew 6, verses 24 to 34. It says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, yet I say to you that even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now, if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you? O you of little faith, therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all of these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient is the day for its own trouble. In closing today, let's take a look at our own hearts regarding debt. Where do you find yourself in any of these positions that we've talked about today? Is there sin in your heart? Or have you dealt fraudulently, like Mr. Badman did with his creditors, beguiling and deceiving people, Ponzi scams, and you could name a number of things that have been done to defraud people out of money. Are creditors knocking at your door? Or have you been faithful or haven't been faithful in your tithing, as is commanded in the Word of God? Or like these examples that we have just read, have bad things just come upon you maybe you find yourself as a widow woman and your husband passed away and you're left in debt and you cannot pay for the things that are owing. There are a number of situations, as we've highlighted in this chapter, and I think they're really worthy of review. Now is the opportunity to make things right. God sees what's going on. Nothing is surprising him. Nothing is shocking him. He's aware of everything. What he's looking at today, brother or sister, is your heart. What's going on inside of there? And the best thing to do is to call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. So why don't we pray together? Let's commit this into his hands. And I know Holy Spirit is going to be working right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, I lift up each person who is watching this program. Lord, only you know what situation they find themselves in, and you know their heart. And that's what you're doing right now. You are ministering and you are bringing conviction in their heart. And I ask, Father, that they would repent if they find themselves that they have beguiled people, that they have sinned, that they have not been paying their tithes. Holy Spirit, that you would bring great conviction in your heart because you want us to repent. You want us to turn around. Or Father, if they've just fallen onto bad times and they're in debt because of some other person's shortcomings where they missed it. Heavenly Father, I ask for your intervention right now in the name of Jesus. I ask that you would supernaturally and miraculously provide, even as we've read in the stories today about Peter and Jesus, they needed money to pay off taxes, these widows who needed to pay off their debtors. Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would supernaturally and miraculously provide. We ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. What a great chapter we've had today. I would really encourage you to watch the other videos. If you haven't, go to our video link on our website, again, salvationstudiohouse.com. And I just want to mention also in closing, there are a lot of other reviews that we've done. We've done Pilgrim's Progress. We've done Christiana's Progress. There are scripts that we've written. So please make sure that you read any of the other reviews that have been done and scripts that have been written. It's so amazing. If you're in the Didsbury area, we would love to have you join us for church. Our services are at 3 p.m. on Sunday afternoons. Also, we highlight Christian movies at Salvation Theater, Saturday nights at 7 o'clock, so you're more than welcome to come. Again, Richard and I really want to thank you for spending this time with us, and we would really love to have your participation and join us for our next program. God bless you.